it.
Take your time.
They removed 5 feet of my intestines last year and gave me 2 weeks to live. They're still here. But I'm struggling. And I ask you for your prayers.
Okay?
No weapon formed against me will prosper. See, I never had any children. I never married. I lived alone most of my life. Jesus was enough for me.
Yes.
Then for a minute, he wasn't.
Because
the church hurt me. It's my fault that I didn't self-govern my life with the world in the condition that it's in. It's not the world's fault. It's the church's fault. No guilt or condemnation. Jesus said they'll know your mind by the love that you have for one another. Amen? I don't know that you love me because you did me right. I know that you will know that I love you because you did me wrong.
Okay.
Jesus' final commandment was that you love one another.
Yes.
And lay down your life for one another.
That's right.
That would fulfill the commandments.
Yes.
I don't promote sin, but if you commit adultery against me, I'm to love you.
That's right.
Not throw you away.
That's
you
right.
If you lie to me,
yes.
I'm to love you.
Yes.
Not throw you away. That's fulfilling the commandments. See, Jesus said that there were treasures in darkness, and I want to know them. I want to have them. But little did I know how deep he would allow me to go. He said, if you make your bed in the depth of hell, I'll be there. See, I used to go to the homeless shelters and sing to them and feed them, and then I became homeless. I had compassion on them. Now I love them. Because I am them. I used to go to the prisons and sing, and then I had to go in there. I had compassion, and then I had to go in there. Because I am the prisoner. Amen? See, I'm all people. And Jesus said, I'm not letting you go of this until you embrace this journey. Because when I was 9 years old in a home, I never heard of God or Jesus. But I heard my name. Three times he said, I want to know you. And I remember from that moment on, I was consumed. I want to know what love is. Little did I know love just spoke to me. In all the days of my life, I've been consumed. What is love? Love is not a what.
Yes.
It's who he is. See, Jesus showed me I don't have the power to love anybody. I have the power to give up my life.
That's right.
And let him live his life through me. Because I'm no good. Only he is.
You need to think about that.
It's the end, y'all.
Yes,
it is.
We're at the end. And he's coming back.
Yes, he is.
But his church, it says the earth is groaning for the manifestation of the sons of God. That's me and you.
That's right.
It's groaning, it's spitting itself up.
Yes.
I don't blame the world for the condition it's in. Take responsibility.
Yes.
I didn't self-govern my life and I lost my freedom. And I returned to my vomit a minute. And guess what? I'm free now. You know where I left Texas? To get free. Jesus said those that are led by my spirit don't know where they're coming from and they don't know where they're going. I don't have a clue where I'm going, but I know where I come from. I lost everything. I had a two-story house, 10 acres, great job. But I didn't have love. I used to sing praise and worship and the people would come and want to talk and I didn't want to talk. And I got home one day and I said, what is this, Lord? I don't want anybody talking to me. I don't want to talk to anybody. And I opened up to a scripture and it said, to them, you have a lovely voice and you play an instrument well. They say with their mouths they love you, but their hearts are far from
you.
Well, I lived alone for 20 years and I was asked to preach a sermon. I never preached a sermon. I fasted for 6 days because Sunday was coming. And I thought I could get a word of the Lord. Silly me. I climbed out of the shower on Saturday night, and it's as though somebody walked in my bathroom. And it was so real that I took the towel to cover myself, and I heard the Holy Spirit say, I'm going to strip you of everything too much. I love you. That was in 05. Will you love me if I'm drunk? So I stayed drunk. Will you love me if I'm high? So I got high and stayed high until it wasn't an issue anymore. Everything that they told me not to do, I did. Because sin isn't the issue. Love is. Love is the issue. Sin's been taken care of. And there is no love without sin. The miracle of the cross is when you love somebody in their sin. That's what will change them. Not be good and don't be bad, because Santa Claus is coming to town. And he's got a list and he's checking it twice, trying to find out who's naughty or nice. No, we were all raised like that. And we imagine that God is still like that. I still do. I still struggle. He paid for it. It's done. It's finished. And I have this to say. Blessed are those that dwell together in unity. In the name of the Lord.
Lord, we keep coming out here and people act like they know you, but they won't say anything about you. God reached all the way down in Texas. They didn't know they were coming this way, but God knows how to do it. God knows how to do it. You don't have to say nothing. God will be anywhere he wants to be. And people come and sit up and play in the house of God. God is not happy. This woman of God walked this floor last night with that word. Like she said, this community needs to see unity. And they need to feel love. I saw something this morning. I won't even tell you what I saw the wee hours of this morning. The Lord had me to wake up at 4:16 and look out the window. And what I saw appalled me so. And then I thought about it. I said, now what if somebody from the church had been out there? We might have been able to help this situation. But we so busy doing us, we won't go there. We'll just leave that alone. I'm just so thankful tonight for this precious sister all the way from Texas. She told me when she came under the tent, she said, the Lord sent me here. Can you tell he did? I can tell God sent her here. And you know what? I talked to a gentleman today, and I hope that he'll show up. Are you here? I asked him to come. He had 15 counts against him in jail. He was on his way to prison for more than 28 years. Didn't God drop the charges? Didn't God drop the charges? I told him today, his mother called me. Well, first I called his mother, then his mother called me back. And she said, I found my son. I know where he is. Will you talk to him? I said, sure I will. And as we began to talk, that young man just began to melt. And he just kept saying, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. I said, will you come? He just got out 1 week ago. I'm hoping and praying to God. See, when they come, we can't be so pious and high-minded and so dressed up that we can't get down there with them. We got to be able to get down there with them. I don't care how much the skirt costs. I don't care how much the blouse costs. We got to be able to get down there with them, because that's just clothes. I give away more clothes than some boutiques have. I'm telling you the truth. But we got to be able to get down there with them. And when they get up, we get up together. In spite of what they've done, that's not our business. That's between them and God. Anybody tonight, God bless you, young lady. Are you standing to talk? God bless you, my baby is coming. She wants to tell her story. This little girl, how old are you now? She's been around since she was, what, 2? Amen.
Well, last winter, I spun out of control in my car several times. I crashed into a snowbank. I had a Sebring 1995. It got me where I needed to go, but it was some work. And I said, God, I just can't do it again this year. I can't have this same car. I don't feel safe. So
take your time. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord.
And I was driving home. I'm tired. So I said, God, I can't continue to drive this car. It's not safe. I'm not going to make it in this car. And so I just got a job at OnStar. And I'm like, okay, this is a good job. Maybe I can save up and get a car. But I was already a week and a whole with the job. And it just wasn't enough time. And I needed a new there's a deer shed at the end of my block. And I walked in there looking for a crew. They didn't have any available. So I started looking at available. And they told me for $2,000 down, I could get it for $250 a month. I said, okay, that's good, but God, I don't got no money. So I'm at work. I got a phone call. They said, for $1,000 down, you can get it for $250 a month. I said, that's even better, but I ain't got $1,000. So I said, let me go in there just to see what else they're talking about. And a man came up to me and said, we have a 2015 Chevy Cruze available. So I drove a car and I'm like, yeah, God, I want this car. This is my car. And I went back in there and they said, for $0 down, you can get this car for $250 a month.
There you go. God bless you tonight. We thank God for all the songs and the testimony. We see that our speaker has come in, and we want to give her ample time to break the word to us again tonight. And so, having said that, come on and put your hands together. We're going to ask. Sinai here, choir. Do we have enough to sing? The preacher asked that if the choir would come. As many of you as they are. If not the choir, just will you sing? I heard you say you're a praise singer. Come on up here. Come on up here. We have no respect for prayer singing. Anybody with a testimony like yours, you're going to sing something that we're going to like.
Soon and very soon, yeah. We are going to see our King, hallelujah. Soon and very soon, we are going to see our King, let's praise God. Soon and very soon, we are going to see our King, hallelujah, hallelujah. We're going to see our King, no more tears.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so, little one. sons to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loved me. Yes, Jesus loves me.
She coming right down our lane, our alley, our boulevard, wherever we reside, she coming right through. So having said that, everyone standing at this time, as we bring to our front, and we do want to acknowledge our bishop tonight. He's taking a little seat for a couple of days, but we thank God for him on tonight. I like that man. It makes it easier to love somebody than you like him. I love people I don't like, I'm going to be honest with you, but I really like him. I thank God for him. Amen. But having said that, will you put your hands together and receive the woman of God, our revivalist for tonight, Prophetess Toya Haddon.
Clap your hands and give God praise tonight. That sounded like that might have been for me. Clap your hands and give God praise. Thank God for being here on tonight. You may be seated in his presence, giving honor to God. On tonight, for the second night of us being here, to the shepherd of this ministry, the house, Bishop Samuel Moore. Amen. Clap your hands and give God praise for Bishop Moore and to his lovely wife, amen, and neighbors with him, Evangelist Catherine Moore. We thank God for them all tonight. To Bishop Bluestein, amen, and his wife, amen, Lady Bluestein, to the musicians, all of the deacons, the ministers, amen, and to you, give God praise, amen, for every breath under this tent we give God praise for, amen. Somebody did not wake up this morning, but I thank God that I'm being seen and not viewed. Y'all ain't hearing nothing I'm saying. I said, I thank God I'm being seen and not viewed on today. Hallelujah. That's a reason to give God praise right there. I want to ask all the house of prayer for all people, if you will, just kindly stand. Yeah, I'm doing a head count. I want to see house of prayer. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Give God praise for house of prayer for all people today. Amen. We thank God for all of them that were here, those that were able. Amen. I thank God for house of prayer for all people. They are a powerful, group of people. Amen. And for my ministerial team, you couldn't have a better ministerial team than House of Prayer for All People has. Amen. They can prophesy, they can lay hands, they can heal the sick, they can cast out devils, do everything that that Bible said they're supposed to be able to do. Amen. And I thank God, amen, that he assigned me to their life. Amen. Come on, let's give God praise for the ministers. It's a privilege to be an honor, and it's a great blessing to be able to just preach the word, do the altar call, and you don't have to come out the pulpit. Oh, y'all don't hear me. Amen. And all of them are equipped, amen, to do the work. And I don't have to give everything out of myself every week. Amen. And the only time I come down is when God said, go touch that one right there. But other than that, they got the power of healing and deliverance all over them. And I thank God for them. Amen. Because it takes a lot of the weight off. Amen. Amen. So I thank God for my ministerial team. They are awesome. Amen. That was that song was saying. And they're multi-talented as well. The young lady that just sang is a co-pastor, Dawn Turner. Amen. She came to the ministry as a co-pastor, was ordained and licensed. So I didn't believe I should be able to reduce nobody from what. Amen. So, and then we have Pastor Ken Hutchins. Raise your hand, Pastor Ken. Amen. He came to us with that, in that position. And his wife, Pastor Linda Hutchins, she's not here tonight, but she's also my traveling armor bearer. Amen. And we'll be hitting the road next Wednesday, headed down to St. Louis, Missouri. Amen. We going down there to give the devil a black eye. Amen. We going down there to woof him on. Amen. Oh, y'all ain't ready. Anybody ready to have some church tonight? Y'all ready? Y'all need to, anybody need to get something off your chest? Amen. Before we get, amen, you know how we are. We need to get stuff off our chest sometime. You got something on your chest, go and get it out so that you can be free to receive from God. Amen. If you got an ought against the person sitting next to you, tell them I forgive you and I love you anyhow. Amen. Because if you don't forgive them, whatever you holding on to for them, God gonna hold on to something for you. Amen. Come on, somebody need to give. I want everybody to stand to your feet real quickly. Let's loosen up the atmosphere. Amen. I need you to go to about three people that you don't know and give them a hug and tell them that you love them in Jesus' name. Thank you. Amen. Amen. Now, you feel better now? How do you feel now? You know, I believe in doing that because I believe that when we love on one another, we release the power, we release God into the atmosphere because God is love. Amen. And sometimes we be so tight, amen, and so compressed with what we had to deal with to get to this hour of the day that we need to release some things. Amen. And the best way to get free is to let love be released in the house. Amen. There's no greater power. There's nothing greater than love. Amen. The Bible said that it covers a multitude of sins. Amen. Because Jesus loved us so much that he gave his only begotten. God loved us so much that he gave his only begotten son. Amen. That whosoever believeth in him would not perish but shall have an everlasting life. How many have that tonight? And the most amazing part in that is that we didn't have to do anything to get it. All we had to do is receive it. Y'all, come on somebody. You can dot every I and every T, but you can't do nothing to earn what Jesus did for you because he paid it all. Oh, come on somebody. My salvation is not in my goodness, but it's in the finished works of Jesus Christ. Do anybody understand that? I gotta share this. Y'all know I like to get you laid. I like to laugh. And I think that we should be the happiest people in the world. Because number one, I got the keys to the kingdom. Because whatever I bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever I loose on earth, tell me that ain't a key. Oh, y'all don't like me already. Hallelujah. He said, I give you the keys to the kingdom and whatsoever you bind on earth. That means whatever I say is bound, is bound. Whatever I say is loose, is loose. So I believe that I should be one of the happiest people in the world because I'm saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost on my way to heaven, and ain't nothing the devil can do about it. Y'all don't like me. Once I accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior, it was cast in stone that I belong to him. And there is nothing that I can do to undo what has already been done. Y'all don't like me. Hallelujah. So we need to understand that laughter is a part of the joy that the Lord has given to me that the world can't take away. I can laugh and have joy when all hell is breaking loose around me because of the God I serve. If he was able to raise Catherine from the dead, oh God, then come on, and not only that, he raised Jesus from the dead, and he wasn't there for 2 hours, but for 3 days. Y'all don't hear me? After 3 days, y'all come on. I guess it wasn't enough for you, but it was enough for me. And so I was getting ready today, and I'm blessed to have my mother. She's supposed to live with me, but she really don't. She got a bed, clothes, all that at my house, but she ain't up there. And I know it's because I'm way out in Romulus, but I'm getting ready to change that. I'm a little closer. I ain't coming back to Detroit, but I'm gonna get a little bit closer. Somebody, one of the realtors said, you need to invest in the city. I said, we already invested. We got that 2 buildings right there on 7 Mile. Oh, I don't need nothing else, amen? But I was getting ready, evangelist. And I kept putting on different shirts and coming and say, how does it look? And we laughed so hard. She said, if you wear that, your church gonna try to figure out what happened to you. I said, I'm gonna come up under that tent. They said, uh-oh, pastor done got saved, y'all. Something that got on pastor. Look how she looking. She done messed around and got a second dim. Amen. So we had fun with that. I was trying to find something appropriate. Amen. To wear. Not just appropriate to wear, because all of my clothes are appropriate to wear if I wear them, but something appropriate to preach in. Amen. Amen. So it's a difference in what you choose. And I just thought that would be something that would make you laugh a little bit, that I was trying to look real holy tonight. Amen. How y'all think I did? Okay. your salvation is not in your attire. He said, say it again. Salvation has nothing to do with the clothes that you have on. Amen. It's the garment that you wear. Come on, somebody. Oh, come on. It's a garment. It's not an outfit, but it's a garment. Come on, somebody needs to hear me tonight. Hallelujah, because I done found some of the longest skirts that's coming up. Oh, y'all. What'd I say? The long ones come up just the same direction as the short ones do. Amen. One thing you're gonna find out about Pastor Haddon, the skirt ain't coming up. They done found out, they leave me alone. Amen. They try everything. Oh, they try everything. I'm looking for a wife. Oh, yeah. Play alone, go out to a couple of real expensive restaurants. Right. So you looking for a wife? Oh yeah, well take me to there. Okay, I wanna go to Texas, then Brazil, and Ruth Chris. I wanna go there. I ain't been there yet. My rascal figure out I ain't going nowhere. You know, I don't want a date right now. Oh, okay, then talk to you later. They find out that I'm saved for real. Oh, come on, somebody. And women, they'll say, I don't know why I'm talking like this. But evidently, it's a reason. They say they want a woman that loves God as much as they love him or more. And then when they find out that you the real deal, oh, come on, somebody. They go to scribbling out, well, you churchy. You religious. And you know, I got a smart mouth. And I said, now what you mean to say is, you want somebody to love God long enough until you tell them to love you. And then when it's time to love you, you want them to put their love for God down, love you, and then get back up and say, oh, we repent, I'm sorry. But it don't work that way in this camp. Amen? It don't work that way in this camp. Anything I ever done, I never did it by mistake. I did it intentionally. Y'all don't like me. Hallelujah. So you ain't gonna get no oopsie out of me. Come on, somebody. Because if I do something, I'm doing it because I want to do it. Not because nobody made me do it. The devil didn't have nothing to do with it. I made the choice and the decision. Oh, come on. Y'all don't hear nothing I'm saying.
Come on, Pastor.
So don't play me with no oops, that wasn't supposed to happen. Yes, it was, and we planned it.
Yes.
Oh, y'all don't like me at all. It was planned.
Yes.
Premeditated.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
Yes.
I don't even know why I'm talking about that. Somebody need to hear that. Somebody working on you. Oh, come on, somebody. Somebody working on somebody. Trying to wear you down, but don't you wear down. Hallelujah. Don't you let nobody wear you out. If they can't respect the fact that you a woman of God or a man of God, step, because it's drama, it's trouble, it's confusion, it's a delusion, it's a hindrance, it's a setback. Come on, somebody need to give God praise. Anytime somebody trying to rush something out of you, it's sin from the enemy, because the Bible says that all good and perfect gifts, y'all ain't ready for me tonight. Oh, come on, somebody need to give God praise. I know Evangelist didn't know till last night, because she was still calling me Haddon Johnson. That been over. And it's a sad thing that... it's sad that you know, you want to be married, you want to be do things properly, but these folks out here is full of foolishness. In and destroy. See, the ministry is number one. My husband come first, but that's after God. Oh, come on, and after the call, after what God. And if you can't understand that, then something is wrong. And so she didn't know, so I didn't say no. I see she fixed it tonight, though. She said, Pastor Haddon. Amen.
And I'm not bitter. I'm better.
Yes.
Amen. I don't dislike nobody. I love them. I loved them before they did what they did. I still love them, but they just ain't good for me. Amen. I pray for them and pray that God will bless them with somebody that can understand them. Amen. Somebody that can help them to see the way. I know I can't evangelize everybody. My anointing ain't for everybody. Amen. And so I don't hold nothing against nobody. I'm moving on. You move on and God bless you. And Simon out. And God is so good, Bishop. You know, I hadn't seen the fella since the court date. And when we divorced, I had a CTS and a Pontiac. Since the divorce, I got the CTS, the XTS, and still the Pontiac. Now, wait a minute. I'm riding up 7 miles. I preach Sunday morning, and guess who pulled up to the light next to me? Well, I got some shout music. I don't like me.
That's all right. That's all right.
Yes.
That's okay.
And I was like, see, y'all don't know when God doing something. I said, that wasn't nothing but God. And he didn't want me to see. He was stretching his neck trying to see. I wanted to let all the windows down and be like, check it out, boo. Y'all don't like me. And I was on my way to baptize somebody. I had the biggest smile on my face. I said, God, you ain't nothing but good. And after he seen all that loveliness, he tried to act like he ain't seen me. So the next light caught him. I pulled up real slow. Y'all don't know how to do nothing. Come on, somebody give God praise. I just pulled up real slow. You know, they just cruised it up to him and just and parlayed for a little while. You know. Y'all don't. Somebody clap your hands and give God praise. See, what the enemy meant for babe, the Bible said God will turn it. He'll flip-flop it. He'll shift it, hallelujah, and he'll make it good for you. Come on, somebody need to give God praise. You see, that's why I'm not upset. That's what you call sweet revenge. You don't have to say nothing. The Bible says vengeance is mine, right? Tell me if God didn't do it. And not only that, I'm moving out the apartment that I was forced to move into after living in my own house for 10 years. And on Saturday, I'll be moving into my own house. Had that car for a week and a half, got up for church on a Sunday morning and all four tires was gone. Wow. I couldn't understand how somebody could do something so beautiful like that. You know, I just like, I can't believe this. I looked out my window and I said, it looks like Stella don't have no shoes on her feet. And so, you know, when you get 27, your eyesight ain't as good as it used to be. So I went and got my glasses and put my glasses on and looked out. I say, Stella out there barefooted. Y'all don't even like me, do you? The drummer looking at me like, what kind of mess is this? Just stay on the drums, don't worry. Everything gonna work out just fine. I'm gonna preach. But I like to talk to the people and just, you know, loosen you up, yes, because yes. We be so stiff.
Yes, yes, yes.
We be church people. We so stiff in church, it ain't even funny. And you want somebody to follow your God, follow you to your God, and your God got you walking around like this. That's why I don't like, I love Tamala Man, but take me to the king, I don't think so. It's too sad. Who
to go to the king of before time. Y'all ain't finished with me yet. He ain't finished with me yet. I got a long way to go, but I'm doing way better than what I used to be. And I'm preaching whether you know it or not. I just have a way of doing things and saying things that other people can't do and say. Because it's Toya Haddon's way. Amen. And I can get away with it, and other folks better not even try it. Amen. And God told me he wanted to use all of me. And I said, you know, my niece told me, she said, Auntie, you are hilarious. And I said, but I don't even be trying to be. She said, I know, but it's just you. She said, you be preaching and you be having me cracking up. The way that you bring it, she said, and it's so simple that the two-year-old can understand it. But some of the things that you say have me laughing. And next week, I think about it and crack up laughing again and say, that woman knows she was right.
Yes.
So everybody can't be you. You can't be everybody. And everybody ain't gonna like you. And guess what? I done got to the point where that's okay.
Yes.
Amen. You don't have to like me, but I still get you delivered.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Whether you like me or not, you can keep on going on about your business and still don't like me, but I want to see you foot anyhow.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Liking me is not the point. Hearing me is what I want you to do. Amen. I want you to hear what the Lord is saying. Amen.
Amen.
I see Minister Weldon here tonight and his beautiful wife. Come on, let's give God praise for them. I love him so much. Amen. He's always been supportive to us. Who else? My mother is here with me again tonight. Amen. Raise your hand, Mom. Amen. I'm right there with your hand. Wave it again. They can't see you. Stay away. There it is. Amen. That's the one that I kicked for 9 months. Amen. She probably had some stuff going on when she was carrying me that she didn't have going on with the rest of them. Because I was the special. My elder. Now, stand up, elder. This right here is an honor.
All right.
The reason I say that is because not only is she the elder of the church and she serves me, but this is my best friend. This is my ride or die, y'all. If I say somebody bother me, that's the one. Right? But the blessing in that is she knows me without this mic. Oh, y'all don't like me. She's the one that watched me go through the two divorces from the same man. Y'all don't hear me. Oh, y'all, it's okay. She's the one that watched, that know my tears. She's the one that heard my frustration, saw my anger, felt my hurt, stayed in my apartment with me for almost 2 months when I couldn't stay there by myself. I wasn't ready to be by myself, and I'm like, look, you going home? You know, you go through something traumatic, you need somebody. There she is right there. Come on, y'all can be ready with that. Thank you for loving me unconditionally. Amen. She made me see that. I hope I ain't getting ready to leave here. Oh, what am I talking about it? No, I ain't going nowhere. I got 12 more days. Amen. But I thank God for her. I thank God for my whole church because they went through this with me. And they stayed right there.
Amen.
And they prayed me through.
Amen.
But they knew I did what I did because I felt that it was the right thing to do.
Yes.
And I felt that was my husband. He said he wanted his wife back, and so I felt like it was the right thing to do, and I accepted him back. But how many know sometimes God will allow us to go through some things to teach us, to train us, to perfect us, to strengthen us. I'm better now. I love people, but I don't have that sob story spirit no more. I'll be like, okay, let me watch you for a minute. Amen. And so I thank God that he has held the house together through all the Toya stuff. See, a lot of people, preachers won't say this. Through my trials, through my situations that I had to go through, that he held the ministry together. And not only that, it's growing. Oh, y'all. That he made it an assignment to tear the house apart. but God, when God put a house together, come on somebody, when God put the house together, he said that no weapon that's formed against you shall prosper. Come on, he said that he had built his house on a rock, and the gates of hell cannot prevail against what God has built. Oh, y'all ain't ready to have no church, don't nobody got no prayer, but I got a reason to give God glory, because the enemy was literally after my mind. He wanted to take me out mentally, but I stand here with a smile on my face. Oh, come on, somebody, you can give God glory. Represents to me. It represents a hard place, a place where I was hurt and wounded. I said, and you don't nobody know. I said, but I've been fighting a demon of depression for the whole year that I've been here. But I give God praise. Hallelujah, I give him glory. Hallelujah, it was the anointing. Hallelujah, Bishop, that kept my sanity. It was the anointing. Hallelujah, that kept my mind. It was the anointing that gave me peace. It was the anointing that gave me joy. It was the anointing that gave me strength. It was the anointing that kept me standing. Come on, somebody. Bishop, and I preached them, and some of them I called on Saturday and said, it's your turn. And they didn't argue with me. They got up and gave what God gave them, and them people kept me standing. I'm telling you, through one of the hardest times in my life, and when God gave me this house, he told me, he said, when you move into this house, I want you to pull away from everybody. So, you know, I talked back. And I said, God, well, I'm already in solitary confinement way out here in Romulus. And he said, but this pulling away has to do with redefining. I'm getting ready to redefine you and reposition you. This is about ministry destiny. Oh, y'all ain't hearing nothing. And so he said, all you gotta, I just want you to pull away to yourself so that I can give you and take you to where I promised you. He said, no longer will you have to worry about anything. God blessed me, amen, to be able to move into this home. I told the church I wouldn't buy, I wanted that car that's over there, but I wouldn't buy it until I got finished the work on the church. You know what they told me? They said, go get your car if you want it. See, because I didn't want to get another car and then the people go hating on it. Because people hate on stuff. They hate on stuff. And they told me, they said, Pastor, if you want that car, go get it. I had a young lady come preach one Sunday, and she got up in the pulpit, hadn't talked to me except for to accept the invitation to come. Stood up in the pulpit and said, the only reason, first thing she said out of her mouth, she said, the only reason you don't have that car you want because you ain't went to the dealer to get it. That Monday, I said, I'm going. I didn't have to show nothing. All they gave me, all they said I needed was a pen and a signature. Oh, y'all didn't hear that. A little old small town girl like me gave me a brand new Cadillac and said, I ain't need no documentation. I didn't have to show no proof of income. I didn't have to give them nothing. All I needed was to sign my name on the line. I said, give me the pen. Oh, y'all ain't ready. That's how God will do you. Amen. You can sit down. And God told me this house I'm moving in right now is a lease with an option to buy. And God told me, he said, move into that house right there. I looked at several, and that one stayed on the market. And God said, that's the house. He said, go to move into that house. And he said, and the man is going to practically give it to you. Come on, somebody need to give God praise. He told me. I talked to my dad, Bishop Haddon, and I was telling him about the house. He wanted to know where it was. I told him, and I said, in about 6 months to 8 months, I'm going to pay the man on time, and then I'm going to make him an offer. And my dad said, no, don't do that. He said, because see, somebody liable to say, here. And I said, he done heard God. Y'all, come on, y'all ain't hearing nothing. I didn't tell him what God told me. He said, don't say nothing. He said, that man, somebody liable to hand you that. And I didn't tell him that that's what God told me. Amen. I'm glad that I got people around me that hear God as well as I do. And that I'm humble enough to hear from others. Amen. A lot of people in position won't hear from the members of the church, but they can call me and say, Pastor, I had a dream or God showed me something about you. And I said, what did he say?
Uh-huh.
I want to know. Amen. And I've received, amen, from, and a lot of their prophecies have manifested, amen, in my life. And so I don't reject any prophet that I know is from God, amen. How many feel good tonight? How many enjoyed the word last night? I didn't think I preached all that good. I don't think I'll be doing all of that. I want to go to Psalms 103 tonight, and I'm going to be quick, just like I was last night. I'm not like I was last night. Psalms 103. And evangelists already tapped into some of this message, and I've heard some things being said already that has confirmed the word that God has given me for tonight. So Psalms 103, verse 8 through 12, and then stick your finger at Hebrews chapter number 10, verse 14 through 17. But we're going to start on the Psalms 103. I'm sorry. Yeah, give me my Bible to Psalms 103, verse 8 through 12. Then go to 1 John. We got three places to go with this. I got a little story I want to tell tonight. I pray that it bless you. I wish I could sound a little bit louder. Can that happen? Psalms 103.
Yeah,
mess
it up.
Uh-huh, 103, verse 8 through 12. had it on there, close it, sorry. And go to 1 John chapter number 1, verse 6 through 9, Hebrews 10, 14 through 17. We're going to read a little bit tonight. 103, thank you, Elder. Verse 6 through 9, and it reads in the 6th verse of Psalms 103, the Lord executed righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens is above, high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Now go to John, 1 John chapter number 1, verse 6 through 9. And it reads, 1 John chapter 1, verse 6 through 9. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. There go that light again. And the blood of Jesus Christ, as his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Hebrews chapter number 10, verse 14 through 17. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified, whereof the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us. For after that he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, said the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them, and their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. All that reading I want to draw right here from the 17th verse of Hebrews chapter number 10, and their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Look at somebody next to you and say, why choose to remember what God has chosen to forget? Look at somebody else that's struggling with some stuff that they did and they feel.